Whether you are here in person or online, we have something for you. Attending in person allows you to be with others and to serve. And for those with kids, we have programming for kids and students, birth through 12th grade. Having our adult service available online and on demand is great because there are times and reasons why we may not be able to come to a building. Whichever way you are joining us, you are welcome. God wants to speak to you today, and we are excited that you are here. For families with kids, birth through fifth grade, there is in-person programming in Bridgetown Kids every Sunday. Kids are gonna worship, they're gonna play games, they're gonna meet and make new friends, and they're gonna learn truths from the Bible in a fun, interactive, and age-appropriate way. Our children's ministry space, it's bright, it's colorful, it's clean, and it's staffed by trained and background-checked volunteers. All kids are invited, and all kids are welcome. For families with students in 6th through 12th grade, there is in-person programming in BCSM, Bridgetown Church Student Ministries. On Sundays, students start in a separate space that is designed with them in mind. They're going to spend the first half of the time playing games and hearing Bible teaching that applies directly to their lives and their situation. And then after the lesson, students join the adults for musical worship and the conclusion of the service. In BCSM, they get a chance to be a part of a community of people who love and care about them while they're exploring God's purpose and mission for their lives. BCC, as a church, exists to love our community and invite them into a life-changing relationship with Jesus. For individuals, couples, and families, we can accomplish that mission when we help you think about and talk about what the Bible is teaching us. And so every Sunday, one thing we do to help with that is to publish three different videos that you can use during the week to do just that. We call these family worship videos, and each video connects you into what was talked about in Bridgetown Kids, in BCSM, or in the adult service. And so whatever environment you are in on Sunday, you will benefit from watching each video every week. These videos and more are available on our website at bridgetownchurch.com, and so be sure to check it out. Now, let's get things started.
Good morning, church. Would you stand and sing this morning as we worship God?
Impossible.
go ahead and have a seat.
Things that don't seem to go together, but when you put them together, they actually work. That's a question I put out to the Facebook community this week, and I received a lot of pretty funny answers. My example was growing up, we often would take two pieces of plain white bread, smear ketchup all over it, and then put a piece of American cheese on it. So it was a cheese and ketchup sandwich. And I know it sounds gross, but it's actually pretty good. And I have I'll put up here a picture, I think, of some of the feed. I won't be able to read all of these, but people said peanut butter sandwiches and chili, green beans and ketchup. I know. Fries and Frosties, men and women. That one's pretty funny, Jen, like that. Peanut butter and bananas. My grandma used to put ketchup on mashed potatoes. Ketchup and mac and cheese. Cheese and mayo. Corn and macaroni. It goes on and on. I mean, there are 97 responses. Thinly sliced potatoes on pizza. I don't know about that. Ketchup and scrambled eggs. Chocolate and jalapenos. We have pineapple and pizza. Opposites in marriage. Watermelon and mustard is apparently a thing. Gross. Pet friends, turtle and a dog. I liked this one, Billy. Boeing 747, 6 million non-flying parts. Get it? A bunch of non-flying parts. They go together. That's pretty good. Chex Mix and chocolate milk, pizza and milk, crackers and milk, all kinds of milk and weird stuff. Bacon and donuts. Now, I think bacon and donuts goes together. To me, bacon works on anything. Fried rice and baked beans, laughing and crying. I mean, it just goes on and on here. Let me see. Oh, what was the one? Where's the one from Kyle here? Here, Margaret, yours was good. I know for a fact a tall man with long legs and a short woman, they fit well together. We have children to prove it. Somebody's always got to just take it to a different level, right? Potato chips and cottage cheese and intelligent agency. I don't know about that one. But somewhere down here, I'm scrolling down here. There's so many, I just can't read them all. Jump on my Facebook feed. Where is Kyle? So Kyle Klasner said French fries on a salad. I don't even know what's up with that. My Aunt Jada said I have a friend who eats ketchup on her pancakes. And somebody else said strawberry jam on grilled cheese. I don't know. I think what this whole thing showed me is I need to get some new friends. That's what I figured out after putting this out there on Facebook and having all of these responses. Man, ketchup and green beans. I mean, some mustard and watermelon. Some of this stuff is just really pretty out there. And we just know, some things just don't go together. And I suppose when it comes to food, that's okay. Like, you may never eat a jalapeno and a piece of chocolate together. And that's okay. Like, you can live your whole life and be happy with that. But I think sometimes it gets into our way a little bit because we assume certain things don't go together inside of the church, when in reality they do go together. And that gets in the way of how God intended the church to be. We're in a series, we're working our way through the book of Ephesians. It was written by Paul, a church planter, and he had been planting churches for about 30 years, and then he was put on house arrest, and he wrote in order to tell the folks in the church in Ephesus what the nature and the purpose of the church was supposed to be. So let me just say welcome. We're glad you're here. Thanks for joining us at Bridgetown, whether you're in person or online. We're certainly glad that you're here with us today. And we're going to continue on in this series. We have these Abide Bible Journals we've made available to you. If you have yours, you can grab it and go along with us. I appreciated this week, one of the reflection questions was, through faith in Jesus, we can confidently approach God. Thank you. Thank Him for revealing the mystery of Jesus to you. And so that was neat just to kind of think about and be thankful to God for revealing the mystery of Jesus in my life. And at Bridgetown, we really believe the Word of God changes people's lives. That one of the best things you can do is daily interact with the Word of God and pray. And if these little journals are helping you in that, then we're certainly glad that's the case. If you don't have one yet, there's some available you can grab on the way out. We're going to pick back up in Ephesians chapter 4. And what Paul has done in this letter is he has shown us who the church is supposed to be in chapters 1 through 3, and now he's going to transition and show us what the church is supposed to do. And here's what he says, follow along with me. He says, "I therefore, the prisoner for the Lord, urge you to live worthy of the calling to which you have been called." We have a calling on our lives if we have Jesus as King, and we are to live worthy of the calling. How? With all humility and gentleness, with patience, putting up with one another in love, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We're going to come back to this, but just notice with me the active nature of these verbs. Putting up with one another, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. Why? Because there's one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope of your calling, one Lord and one faith and one baptism and one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. When it comes to understanding the nature and the purpose of the church, there's a helpful truth right out of the gate, and that's this: that God has chosen us to be Christ's representatives on this earth. The church is meant to represent who Jesus is to the world. A New Testament scholar I like to read, his name is Folks, he says this, that Christians, their conduct follows from the, let me try that again. He says this, he says, Christians' conduct follows from Christian doctrine. In other words, what we believe is meant to affect who we are. And so in chapters 1 through 3, Paul has shown what we believe God to be and who we believe the church to be, and now he's going to show us how to live in light of that. The gospel is meant to transform every part of our lives so that we live worthy of the calling that we have received. And one of the best places to start is where Paul suggests we start: humility, gentleness, patience, and love. Humility, gentleness, patience, and love. You know, when Paul wrote this letter to the church in Ephesus, those were not things that the people in that church saw as signs of strength. In fact, in a Greco-Roman world, they were seen as signs of weakness. You were weak if you were humble, gentle, patient, and loving. And yet Paul says, hey, listen, we're following King Jesus and things are different for us. Jesus knelt in service. He expected humility. He told his followers, put other people above yourself. He was gentle. He didn't grab positions of power even when they were offered to him. Jesus was patient with outspoken crowds and wavering disciples. He encouraged his followers to carry the loads of others without expecting even as much as a thank you, let alone something in return. And it was a different way of living, and it was meant to catch the attention of other people when you followed Jesus as King. And so can I ask you, how are you doing with those things? Would those be words that describe your life, humility and gentleness and patience and love? The purpose of a church is to live out who we are, and we are followers of Jesus. Those are His traits, and they are to be our traits. We tend to compartmentalize and say, okay, in some areas of my life I'll have that, but in other areas of my life I'm not going to live like that. We maybe act a certain way Monday through Friday, and it's a different way on Saturday and a different way on Sunday, and yet we're called to be a people who follow the King every day of our lives, in all ways and on all days, to be following who Jesus is. I have some friends that serve in the United States military as chaplains, and I was talking to one of them lately, and they said, Nathan, when you join the United States military as a chaplain, one of the things that you have to understand is that all areas of your life have to line up with what's expected of the chaplaincy. So in other words, if you get a DUI or a misdemeanor on Friday, then that can disqualify you as a chaplain on Monday. That their lives are put together, that you can be relieved of your duty as a chaplain if you have something in your life that doesn't line up. And I thought, you know, for all the things that maybe the U.S. military doesn't get right, I think that's one thing they do get right, that for a Christian chaplain, their life is supposed to be one that's consistent every day of the week and at all times. But guess what? That's true for all of us who are followers of Jesus. We don't get to just check it out at certain points in times. Make every effort, Paul says, to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Here's what I've learned in being in the church for almost 20 years now. Unity does not just happen. You have to work at unity. Division just happens. Division's easy. Division's natural. Our culture will naturally divide itself very, very quickly, but you have to work at unity. If you don't believe me in this, then simply go somewhere where people disagree on something. Go to the next school board meeting, and you'll see disunity and happen. Come with me to my son's seventh grade football team. We were playing football this week, and I'm watching the team, and a guy catches the ball, and the ref calls it out of bounds, and the people in the crowd, they just go absolutely crazy. These parents are losing their mind because they disagree with what the ref called. And this one mom just keeps screaming over and over again to this ref, "Hey, ref, do you work for the Steelers? Hey, ref, do you work for the Steelers?" And it was just really ugly, and I thought, man, you don't have to look far for disunity in our culture. We can't seem to agree on much of anything, and yet Paul calls us to make every effort to keep the unity. Why? Because we have one body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, and one God. Scholars who study this say that when Paul wrote this, he writes it in such a cadence that it suggests to us that this was something the church in Ephesus repeated often. That this was something they said when they were gathered together as believers. So I'm going to put it back on the screen for you, and I want you to say this with me. I'm going to read through it one more time. I'll have you say it with me. One body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, one God. Ready? Let's say it together. One body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, one God. Good. Let's do it one more time. And if Jesus is your king, say this like it's something that you really believe in. Let's do it together. One body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, one God. When something divides us in the church, when we have a disagreement with somebody and we can't seem to see eye to eye, somebody ought to say, hey, you know what? We can agree on. We can agree that there's one body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, one God. And as far as Paul is concerned, that spiritual reality is strong enough to overcome any disunity that otherwise would be a part of the church. They had that list memorized. They said it. Much like how we might say the Lord's Prayer or a Hail Mary, the early church, when they got together, they remembered the oneness, the unity of the church. And I want to camp here for just a moment because it's so easy for us to get divided. Believers, we are one in body. Our unity is experienced with connection within the church. We are one in spirit. Our unity is experienced with the Holy Spirit who activates our love for one another. We are one in hope. Our unity is experienced in the glorious future that we have in knowing the hope of Christ. Believers, we are one in the Lord. Our unity is experienced in Christ, knowing that we belong to Him as the King. Believers, we are one in faith. Our faith is a singular commitment to who God is. Believers, we are one in baptism. That experience of baptism reminds us that we are in this together with others who have died to an old way of life and who have risen to live again. And its oneness is meant to permeate the church. And the language that Paul uses here suggests a bunch of soldiers who are guarding a city. That's how we're supposed to be as Christians. You should guard the unity of the church like a soldier who's guarding a city, knowing that people are going to attack it, but it's one of the best attributes we have as believers. Christians, we cannot pretend that unity is not a central and vital issue to the church. New Testament scholar N.T. Wright says this, "Unless we are working to maintain, defend, and develop the unity we enjoy, and to overcome and demolish and put behind us disunity, we can scarcely be called followers of Jesus." Church, if we want to live a life worthy of the calling, we have to fight for the unity that is present within the church. The older I get, the more amazed and quite frankly frustrated I get by disunity. It shocks me that Christians who serve together, who participate in small group together, who go to the same church for years, can get so upset and so disunified over seemingly such silly things. How much better off would we be if we remembered one body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, one God? If we rallied around the things we could agree on instead of focusing our attention and effort on the things that we disagree on. Unity is an important component of the church. However, unity does not negate diversity. R.C. Royal once said, "The church of Christ needs servants of all kinds and instruments of every sort. Pen knives as well as swords, axes as well as hammers, chisels as well as saws, Marthas as well as Marys, and Peters as well as Johns." Every part is needed inside of the church. And that's exactly where Paul is going to shift his focus. And I want you to notice this, because sort of like watermelon and mustard, it doesn't seem to go together. And yet, in this case, it does. All of this focus on unity, and now Paul is going to talk about diversity within the church. Here's what he says. Let's pick back up in verse 7 if you're following along in your journal or in your Bible. Check it out with me. He says this, "But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift." Grace was given. Therefore, it says, he's going to quote for the Psalms, and I'll come back to this in a minute. "When he ascended on high, he captured captives. He gave gifts to men. Now, what is the meaning of he ascended except that he also descended to the lower regions, namely the earth? He," we're talking about Jesus, "is the very one who descended, is also the one who ascended above all the heavens in order to fill all things." If it's a little confusing, don't worry. Scholars say those are the three most confusing verses in Ephesians. We'll come back to them in just a minute. "And he himself gave some as apostles, and some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for works of ministry, that is, to build up the body of Christ, until we attain the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God." Notice with me what we are building up towards. We are building up towards the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. A mature person attaining to the measure of Christ's full stature. Can I pause here for just a second? We'll keep going in just a minute. But check this out. Notice what the mark of maturity is. The mark of Christian maturity is not being right. The mark of Christian maturity is getting to the point where you have the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. I think we miss that. We get that wrong. Verse 14, "So we are no longer to be children, tossed back and forth by waves and carried by every wind of teaching, by the trickery of people whose craftiness carries out their own deceitful schemes, but practicing the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Christ, who is the head. From him the whole body grows, fitted and held together through every supporting ligament. As each one does his part, the body builds itself up in love." As each one does his part. Choirs are amazing when everybody's singing on tune. Orchestras sound really good when everybody is playing the part that they're supposed to be playing. It's absolutely incredible. And we are responsible to guard the unity of the Spirit, but to realize that God has made the church very diverse and we all have different gifts to use. Calvin said this, "No member of the body of Christ is endowed with such perfection as to be able without the assistance of others to supply all he needs." It's part of God's grace, according to verse 7, that we have one another within the church. You know, every once in a while I talk to somebody and they say, "Nathan, I don't have to go to church to be a Christian. I don't have to be a part of a church to be a Christian." Okay. You'd be the first. Because there's very much a sense in which being a follower of Jesus, means being a part of the body of Christ, which is interacting with other believers to become the person God has created us to be. That's what Paul's talking about here. There are a lot of ways that we can understand that passage that talks about the Psalms that can be really confusing. I just like to take it the most straightforward way. It's a reflection in the Psalms of how God is the conqueror in the same way Jesus is the conqueror. So Jesus came, he conquered Satan, he defeated Satan through the cross and through the resurrection, and then he chose to give to the church gifts. Notice with me what those gifts are. They are people. You know what the best gift is God ever gave to this church? It's you. It's the people who make this church what it is. That's the gifts God gives to the church. God gives leaders to the church, and the leaders equip the saints for works of service. At BCC, we do this in a lot of different ways. One of the ways we do it is through our website. We talk often about the next tab on our website. You can go there to the next tab, and you can click. I think I have a video just kind of show you what that looks like. And you can go to the next tab. You can click on being interested in serving at BCC. And all these different ministries open up. There's student ministry, and there's children's ministry. There's building and maintenance, and cafe, and community life. Life and creative planning and finances and first impression, leadership, medical, missions, office, prayer, production, worship, on and on the list goes. And we even put an other on there just in case. Just in case you're like, you know, I don't fit into any of those things. All right, you got to fill in the blank. You tell us how you want to be involved in the ministry of Bridgetown Church of Christ and we'll figure out a spot for you. Because we believe we will only become the church God wants us to be when everybody is working together as the body of Christ. And folks, this isn't about getting stuff done. Paul makes it clear in verses 12 through 13 that when we serve, we grow in faith and knowledge. When you serve with other Christians, you grow in your faith and you grow in the knowledge of who Jesus is. God has given the church a huge responsibility. Think with me for a minute about what the call is on our life as the church. We are to go into the whole world and tell as many people we can about who Jesus is, and then we're to disciple them to become followers of Jesus. That is a daunting task. That is a huge task. There would be no reason to even try if we had to do that all by ourselves. But thankfully, God has called us to be members of the body of Christ, and we work together within the church to accomplish what God has called us to. It's human tendency to overestimate what we can do by ourselves and to underestimate what we can do as a group. If you don't believe me on this, ask any guy who ever started a project and said, this will take about 30 minutes. Every time I do that, every time I say to Nikki, you know what, I'm going to go take care of that. I'll be back in about 20 minutes. She just rolled her eyes because I grossly overestimate what I can do by myself. And yet, I really underestimate what I can do with a group of people. Last Saturday, there was 50 people from our church that went down to Block Ministry. And they took half the group over and painted this wall. And they showed me pictures of this wall. It was like 128 foot long. That's twice as long as this room. And they were able to get that wall painted. The rest of us, we stayed in this old house in Price Hill, and we tore out all the plaster and lath. There is absolutely no way two of us could have done that by ourselves. There's no way five of us could have done that by ourselves. But when 50 people get together, it is amazing what they are able to accomplish. And the same is true in the life of the church. It is amazing what we can do when we work together as a church. It's amazing. Many hands make light works. God has gifted the church in a way that all hands are needed. And I hope you hear this truth if you feel lost. Maybe this is your first time at Bridgetown. Maybe it's online or perhaps here in person. You've never been to this church before and you just feel lost. Would you please know that our church will never be all it can be. The church will never be all it can be without you. We need you in order to fire on all cylinders. We need you in order for this church to reach its full potential. God's teaching me a lot this week about this whole passage. 3 weeks ago, my wife and I were getting ready to leave. We were taking my son to football practice. We went up to jump in the van, and I stepped up into the van, and as I stepped in the van, I twisted, and I heard something pop really loudly, and it hurt. Now, being the guy I am, I did nothing about it for 10 days because usually if you just ignore things, they go away, right? That's what I tell myself anyway. Well, it didn't go away. It got harder and harder to walk. And so finally, I went to the doctor, blah, blah, long story short. They send you here, send you there, poke you, prod you. At the end of the day, I have a severely torn meniscus in my right leg. The doctor told me my NFL career is over. I'm devastated by that, but I had big plans for college football, and they just went out the window. But it's so severely torn that in a couple of weeks, they're going to have to go in and cut half of my meniscus out, which is not ideal. So if I seem a little loopy today, it's the ibuprofen, okay? But it's not ideal because I will spend the rest of my life with a part of my body missing. But I asked the nurse, and she said, no one's ever asked me that before. I'll have to check. I said, can I have that when they cut it out of my body? I want to keep it. I want my little piece of meniscus in a jar. So the next time I preach on the body of Christ, I can come up here and I can hold it up and say to you, every part of the body is important. Because I'll tell you what, until 3 weeks ago, I didn't even know I had a meniscus. Like, if you would have asked me, do you have a meniscus? You know what the doctor said? He said, we have to shave off part of your body. I said, if you want to start shaving off body parts, there's a lot of other parts that could use it first. I mean, straight up, I can name a few that could just take a little here, a little there, you know, but that's not the way it works. They have to go from my knee. I don't understand. But really, it's an important part of my body. It's a part that I never even realized it was doing what it was supposed to be doing. It's been there for 41 years, just chucking along and doing what it's supposed to be doing, and now all of a sudden it's hurting, and it's making my whole body hurt. Man, the body of Christ. We are to fiercely guard the unity of the church. And at the same time, we are to promote and celebrate the diversity of the different gifts God gives to the church. Even if what you do doesn't seem all that important, even if you look at it, listen to this verse, from him the whole body grows and is fitted together and is held together through every supporting ligament. Everything matters. Even that little piece of meniscus, it matters. As each one does his part, the body builds itself up in love. We only will get to the point where we are firing on all cylinders, where we're doing what God wants us to do, when we're all stepping in and stepping up to do what God has created us to do. Here's the point of how I would sum up this passage. Through unity and diversity, Christians can live a life worthy of their calling. Man, if you're here, if you're joining us and you're saying, I want to live a life worthy of my calling, I've listened to Ephesians chapter 1, 2, and 3, and I appreciate what God has done for me. I appreciate the call of God on my life. How do I live a life worthy of my calling? You fiercely protect the unity of the church. Fiercely protect the unity of the church. If you see something breaking the disunity of the church, you go after that, and you remind yourself and you remind the other person all of the things we have to celebrate oneness in, one hope, one faith, one baptism, one Lord. That is so important. And at the same time, you celebrate the diversity of the different Christians who serve in different ways. There's so many different ways people serve in this church. We ran a report this week just out of curiosity, and we have about 190 of our partners, which is more people than's in this room, who are serving on teams here at the church. All kinds of different stuff that happens all of the time in order to help the church grow. And it's wonderful when we protect the unity and we celebrate the diversity. Unity and diversity. Watermelon and mustard, right? It just doesn't seem to go together. And yet when Paul starts writing about the purpose of the church, he says, hey, you want to get this church thing right. You protect the unity. You go for the unity. You hold on to the unity. But at the same time, you celebrate the fact that God has made people so diverse. And everybody has a role to play. And the body will never reach its full potential until we're all serving. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this passage of Scripture. God, I thank you for walking with me, for teaching me in life so much every day. And I pray, God, that you would continue to bless this church and help us to be a place where we fiercely protect the unity we have and where we celebrate the diversity of the gifts as we step in and step up to serve. It's in the name of Jesus we pray.
Amen.
I got to see some unity this week, and I just want to celebrate it with you. I can't help but to think of those words, one body, one spirit, one hope, one faith, one baptism, and one God. Alan Hilsinger, who's been a part of our church for a long time, and here just speaking, by the way, of people who just are like meniscus, they just do stuff you don't even know is all that important. Alan is one of these guys that just loves landscaping, and so when it gets really, really dry, he comes up, don't ask him, dude, he just does it. He comes up and he waters the trees and the plants when it gets really dry. So I'll just be driving by, and I'll look over, and there will be Alan standing out there with the water hose, watering the trees out here. Because it's just something he does. He knows it needs done. He just takes care of it. I love it about him. But I've talked to Alan for about 6 years about being baptized, and he made the decision, and he talked to his kids about it, and I was able to baptize Alan and his two kids into a relationship with Christ. So check out this video with me. Yeah, we'll give a hand. Watch this. I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and to receive the gift of the Spirit. All right, buddy. You ready? You want to hold your nose? You're good? Okay. You guys are professionals. So I'm going to do the same with you. I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and for the forgiveness of sins. Okay, we say the best for last. Do you like to hold your nose? You're just going to go under? No problem. So I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of your sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Good job. Congratulations. Alan and his family are with us online today. They weren't able to be here in person, but when you see them, make sure and congratulate them on that awesome decision, Alan and Brecken and Eden. It was really great. We're going to go into our time of communion. If you're joining us online, you can use bread or cracker, juice or water. What we use isn't as important as what we remember. If you're with us in the room, there are packets available on the back table. If you missed them on the way in, go ahead back and grab one. Man, I cannot think of a better way for us to enter into a time of communion than by watching that video and seeing what we just talked about played out. One faith, one hope, one Lord, one baptism. It's amazing the unity we have. And so let's eat and let's celebrate the unity and diversity which are present in the church. I'm so thankful that God did not put the whole weight of the church on my shoulders. I'm so thankful that He has equipped an entire body and He's called us all to be the part that He needs and wants us to be. And so as I just share in communion with you all, it's great to be in this body of Christ with you. So let's drink and celebrate the unity and the diversity of gifts that are present. We're truly glad that you're here with us today. Thank you for joining your church family. We're going to sing in just a moment. During this time of singing, it's an opportunity for you to respond. So if you want to go ahead and stand up with your church family, and you can stand up at home as well and join us. You can visit the next tab if you'd like to take a step of faith. Go over there and sign up to serve in some way. It's not a lifelong commitment. It's a chance to just check out a serving team and see how God may want to use you as a part of this body of Christ, because you are needed. It's important that you're a part of what's happening here. You may want to come during the time of singing. We'll have a prayer team available. You could come up for some prayer today just to talk to someone. Maybe watching Alan and Brecken and Eden be baptized stirred something inside of you, and you're saying, hey, I would like to make that commitment. I would like to have Jesus as my Lord. You can come. We always have a change of clothes available, and I'd love nothing more than to get in the baptistry with you today and to baptize you into a relationship with Jesus. So take a step of faith as we sing out and we worship God, and we really just celebrate the unity we have in the church and just how diverse the church is, because that's the way God made us, all with different gifts, but all with an important role to play.
between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of
Jesus, yours is a victory. search the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade, they're never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Now every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Is better than
rocking it. Nice. Hey, thank everybody for coming today, whether you're here in person or online. We just want to say thank you for coming. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Briefly, I want to tell you a little bit about what is happening here at the church. As always, you can go to bridgetownchurch.com/next. Everything we're talking about is on there, but we still like to highlight it here at the end of the service. Briefly, want to quickly talk about small groups. This is the end of the day. Today is the last day we can sign up for small groups. So I want to suggest we don't wait until 11:59. If you want to go ahead and do it as soon as church is over, we can jump on. Heck, you can do it right now while I'm talking. But I want to show a quick video just highlighting a little bit more about small groups.
Hello, my name is Nathan.
And I'm Nikki.
And we'll be leading a small group on Sunday nights from 5:30 to 7.
Our group intentionally meets at Bridgetown Church of Christ during BCSM at night, the church's youth group.
We have a young family, and we know that it can be hard to make time for a small group.
By meeting during youth group, we can connect with adults while our teenagers connect with others.
We will be working through the sermon series questions.
This group is specifically designed for parents of teenagers, but anyone is welcome.
We do not provide childcare, but we meet in Bridgetown Kids, and the younger children are welcome to come, and they just play in an adjacent room together.
We hope you join us.
So that is one of the groups that we were having, and we've had a couple questions. Hey, if I'm signing up, am I signing up for small groups for the next 6 years? The answer is no. This session runs through Thanksgiving. So just right before Thanksgiving is what this group runs through. And so that's kind of the commitment level that we're at right now. We will have another session later, and we'll commit for a certain time period for that as well. So sign up for small groups today. Also, Sunday, September 26th from 5 to 7:30, Bridgetown Church is hosting the Healthy Marriage event. We're partnering with Rock Solid Families. And this is just a great way to give you valuable tools to strengthen your marriage. The cost is only $20 per person, so if you're going as a couple, it's $40. That includes dinner and childcare. It's kind of hard to find a date that cheap. So even if you just want a 2.5-hour date, just sign that up. Now listen, we have 8 spots left, but don't be those people that sit here and say, I'm not going to sign up so somebody else can. All right, don't do that. Just sign up. All right, we've got 8 spots left. Sign up. Let's fill that. And we got one more quick video to reinforce this as well.
Hello, my name is Nathan, and I serve as a senior minister at Bridgetown Church of Christ. We're so excited to host a healthy marriage event on Sunday, September 26th from 5 to 7:30 in the evening. We want to give you a night out to invest in your marriage and to spend time with your spouse. Marriage is hard work. The past year has not made it any easier. Job loss, working from home, changing schedules have fractured many homes. We're here to help. This event, led by Rock Solid Families, a Cincinnati-based ministry that specializes in marriage-strengthening events, will provide the needed tools to strengthen your marriage. Whether you're having a great marriage or you're barely hanging on, you won't want to miss out. To register, go to bridgetownchurch.com/marriage. To make things very easy, your registration and payment include childcare and a nice dinner from Taste of Class in Cheviot. This will be a lovely date night. Space is limited, so I encourage you to register right now. And I look forward to having you join my wife, me, and other couples at the Healthy Marriage event.
Boy, Nathan had to do a lot of wardrobe changes today, getting into all these videos. So, and thank you all very much for your generosity. Because of your giving at this church, we are able to do events like this. We're able to do events that we had this past Sunday, where we did the hot dogs and slip and slides. And it's really neat that your generosity and your giving allows us to do things also to help unify the church, as we talked about today. And that's what this past Sunday was about. So, what I want to do today is I want to just excuse us for the day and say, hey, thank you all for coming. And as we leave, there's a fun video just kind of showing a little bit of the highlight of what we had at the end of Sunday last week. So thank you all for coming today. Let's do it again next week. And if you want, you can enjoy this video.